us, to give us wisdom, understanding, illuminate our mind to what the Lord wants us to do continually in our lives. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your goodness and kindness towards us. We thank you, O God, that your goodness had led us to salvation, to repentance and salvation. And we thank you, O God, that you found us and has given us, O God, the most important gift, priceless, O God, and that is eternal life. I pray, Lord, that you will bless us to grow in the faith, in the grace, and in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, so that, Lord, we will be worthy of the salvation that you have given us, although there's nothing that we can do to be worthy of it. It is all of your grace, but Lord, as a token of our love and gratitude, that we may be able, O God, to obey your will, to serve you, and that we can really be a true ambassador of yours, O God, here on earth, so that people that are still at enmity with you will be reconciled, O God, by us doing the ministry that you have entrusted, O God, to go into all the world and to preach the gospel to every creature. But Lord, help us to grow so that we will be effective, as we will know what to do when we obey your words, O God. Bless us, Lord, and give me wisdom, because, Lord, by myself, there is nothing in me that can explain your words, O God. But if the Holy Spirit will see it fit to use me today, I believe, O God, that the whole thing will be a blessing to each and every one of us. And we pray that everything will redound to the glory of your name, because I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you very much. You may be seated. So we are going to study today about a church that is perfecting every member. A church that is perfecting every member. So we can see that when the Lord established the church, there is a purpose. In Matthew 16:18, he says that upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. So there is something that a church should do. There is a reason why the church was established by the Lord Jesus Christ, and this is to storm the gates of hell, so that those that are imprisoned by the devil at their will have the chance to hear about the gospel, and they will have the chance to repent of their sins, open their hearts, and accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. So that these people, those that are lost, will have the chance to also enjoy the forgiveness, the salvation that God is offering, that he purchased on the cross when he died on the cross of Calvary. So that is something that we need to do. We are not just here. We are not just existing. There is something that we ought to do as a church. Amen. But then again, as a church, it is hard for us to do something for the Lord if we are not strong enough, because we are going against the devil. We are battling against the devil. Yes, we're not the ones who are actually battling the devil, but it is very important that we are ready. It is very important that we are available so that God can use us in order to gain victory against our enemy. Amen. So that is why a church must grow. That is why every member of a New Testament church must have a measure of growth, so that the Lord can use us effectively in the ministry. It was presented this morning during our Sunday school that God will never call and God will never use a lazy servant. If you cannot even study the Word of God, then you have no business going out there and telling the people that God called you to preach the Word. Why? You do not even love the Word. You do not even read the Word. You do not even understand the Word. How can you go out there and preach the Word of God? And how can you even convince us that you were called by God if you're not doing what you are supposed to do? If you're going to read the Bible, everybody that God called is doing something for the Lord. They are busy in the things that God has given them to do. So that is why when the parable was presented this morning, that the lazy servant is the only servant that did not receive any reward from the Lord. It is because God Again, we'll never use a person who is not willing and ready to serve God. The person who have denied himself so that God can use him at God's disposal. So we can see here, at the churches at Colossae, they are a church that are perfecting every member of their local churches. We can see that this is not a church that is full of members who never grow. You see, it's sad to say, or even sad to think, that there are members of a local church that are sitting under the preaching every Saturday, or in some churches Wednesday, and every Sunday morning, and every Sunday afternoon, and they are not even growing in the Lord. It is impossible not to grow if you are being fed rightly. It is impossible not to grow if you are cooperating with the Word of God. If you are trying to listen to the Word of God, to understand the Word of God, to meditate the Word of God, and to obey the Word of God, it is impossible for you not to grow. So this is a church whose members are growing. This is not a church that lets the members live contrary to God's Word with no serious effort to change them and no consequences if they don't change. You see, in our time today, many churches are very nominal in everything that they do. It is as if their only duty is to come every Sunday, to sit down, to listen, to go home, and then nothing really happens. Nothing really changed. Nothing ever learned. Ladies and gentlemen, we come to church because God is teaching us, God is making us grow, so that when we go out there, God can use us to glorify His name. That is why, as a member of a church, and as a church, we need to be serious in growing our members in the grace and in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to me. We are not a perfect church, and we will never be here on earth. We are not a church that is better than other churches, but at least we are a church who is doing everything so that our members will learn more of the Word of God. That's why we have Saturday morning. We have three services Sunday morning. We have your Bible class, 8 to 9. We have Sunday school, 9 to 10. And we have our worship service. And this afternoon, we're going to have our interactive worship service wherein you can ask questions regarding the things that we have studied. If you don't understand them, if you have doubts about them, if you think they are wrong, we can discuss them so that whatever we believe by the grace of God is always according to the Word of God, rightly divided. And if we are wrong, we will be humble enough to accept and to adjust according to the Word of God. So we do not say that we are always right, but we want to know what is right by the grace of God. Amen. And the good thing is that we have the Bible. I can teach you, you can teach me, we can study, we can help each other learn and grow in the Lord. Amen? So that should be the attitude of every local church that the Lord has established. We can see that this church means business with God. So what should a church do? We can see here that the church is to fulfill the Word of God. Look at verse number 25. Verse number 25. Whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the Word of God. You see, the purpose of every life actually is to fulfill the Word of God. Amen. You see, when God created man in His image for the purpose of glorifying God. Amen. So that is the very purpose of God. But we know that sin entered into the world and it distorted what God has done. And the devil keep on battling. But the reason why God created man is for His glory. The reason why God established the church is for His glory. Everything that we do must be for the glory of God. The Bible says, whether you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do it for the glory of God. Because that is the very reason why God created us and why God is doing all of these things. So it was the purpose of the Apostle Paul to glorify God. That's why he says, for to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. And he said, this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Everything about the Apostle Paul is to fulfill the word of God. Amen. And it should also be the purpose of every saint and the purpose of every church in this world established by the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, everything must be done in accordance with God's word and God's will. When we do things according to our will, then we are doing amiss. Because what should happen in our lives must be God's plan for our lives. It was very clear. It was mentioned this morning. When you got saved, God has a plan for your life. Our first responsibility, listen, is to know that plan, is to know God's will. And how can we know it? Through the word of God. You see, the reason why we are in a mess right now, we are doing so many experimenting. Okay, you are in a church, and all of a sudden you said, the Lord is calling me to go to that place, and then you will go to that place without ample or enough knowledge of the word of God. And once you are there, you will look at circumstances. If things are good, then the Lord called me here. If things are bad, then the Lord is calling me somewhere else. Why would you even dare to say that God is calling you if you're not sure? But pastor, there is no way to be sure. Who told you? The word of God is given to us so that we can be sure. The Bible says that we can be equipped, that we can be furnished in serving the Lord. Amen? So it is not a matter of experimentation. So what if in every place that you went, nothing is happening? So the Lord is not calling you? You see, Jeremiah is very clear that he was called by God, even in his mother's womb. But did he have or had an easy ministry? No. It was very hard. People do not even want to listen to him. That's why he was known as the weeping prophet. But one thing about Jeremiah, he knew that God called him. That's why when he was discouraged and he is about to quit, that he do not want to do anything with the word of God, he says that the word of God is like fire in my bone and I cannot stay. I have to do the will of God. Why? If it is God's will, do it. No matter what it takes. Amen? So it should be the purpose of every church that everything must be done in accordance with God's will and God's word. The church is at the heart of God's purpose in this present age. It is a serious business with God. When God established the church, God knew that this is the only institution that he will use in order for his will to be done here on earth. How about the government, pastor? Yes, there is the government has a part. The government has a purpose. But the will of God, when it comes to salvation of people, is entrusted to the church. That is why in the same token this morning, when Abraham asked the servant to find Isaac a wife, the most important job was given to the most trusted servant. And the most important thing is the salvation of the lost, and it was given to the church, not the government, but the church. Amen? That is why if we are not going to do this, nobody will do this. If we are not going to go and to preach the gospel, nobody is going to do it, because it was given to the church by God. And then we can also see in this passage that the church is a revelation from God. You see, in the Old Testament, they do not know anything about the church. It was not revealed. It was hidden unto them. So the truth about the church was hidden in the Old Testament era. But during the time of the Apostle Paul, it is being manifested by God to the saints through the Apostle Paul and the Scripture or the Word of God. So the mystery is that Christ will dwell in the Gentiles. That's why in 27 it says, Christ in you, talking to the Gentiles the hope of glory. You see, that is the only hope of glory. It was given to the church. So we can see that true salvation is only in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. That is Christ in you. No amount of good works can save you. No amount of religiosity can save you. No amount of intelligence can save anybody. It is only through the Lord Jesus Christ. We can also see here the salvation is also given to the Gentiles. The salvation is for people who don't have God's law and God's covenant. Do you know why? The problem is this. When God gave the laws and the covenant to the Israelites, they thought that it is the way of salvation. No, it's not. It is a schoolmaster. So what happened to the Israelites is that they took the law for themselves and boasted against other nations. As they say, we have the word of God. We have the oracles of God. We have what we call advantage over you. Yes, they did. They do have an advantage over any other nation during that time. But they messed it up because they became proud and self-righteous. And they did not understand that the law is a schoolmaster that will point them towards the Lord Jesus Christ. But look at the Gentiles. They have no law. They have no covenant. They are without Christ. They were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. And they were strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. And yet, the Lord Jesus Christ offered salvation to them. Amen? And by the grace of God, they were given enough grace to accept this salvation that God has given, and were so thankful that they were used by God in the service of the Lord. Not only that, but we can see that salvation is also riches. That is to be co-heir with the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, if you are saved, you possess all things. I hope we understand that. Because for us, riches is about money. Riches is about possession. But true riches is about possessing spiritual things that money cannot buy and that no man can take away from us. When we got saved, we are joint heir with the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at Romans 8:17. The Bible says in Romans 8:17, and if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. You see, it's not easy here on earth, especially regarding what's happening today. But it doesn't matter. It will only last for the night. Weeping only lasts for the night, but joy cometh in the morning. There will come a time that even though we are suffering now, there will come a time that we will be glorified together with the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse number 21. 1 Corinthians 3:21. Therefore let no man glory in men, for all things are yours. You see, we have the riches of God because Christ is in us. Amen? Salvation is Christ in you. It is the intimate relationship with the Son of God. If you do not have the Son of God, then you are not saved. But if you have the Lord Jesus Christ in you, then you have a relationship with God. Not only that, but we can see that salvation is a hope. It is our blessed hope that one day the Lord Jesus Christ will come and we will be with him in glory. Amen? Because salvation is glory. When Christ shall appear, then we will also appear with him in glory, according to Colossians chapter 3 and verse number 4. So this is something that we need to be thankful to the Lord about. Amen? That God in His mercy and grace and love have turned His sight to us Gentiles. And by turning His sight to us, provoking Israel to jealousy, so that in the end, Israel will realize that Jesus Christ is their Messiah. Amen? So this is one of the purpose why the church is here. And then we can also see in verse number 27 that the church is a body of people who have Christ in you. A body of people, listen, who have Christ in you. Again, this is what we call a regenerate church membership. You study church history. You study the reason why we are in this kind of mess right now. You see, before, we can see in the Bible that the church is making decisions for the things that the church should do according to the Word of God, and there's no problem. They need to replace Judas, there was no problem. They need to find deacons, there was no problem. They were able to choose seven spiritual men to serve the table and at the same time to serve the Lord. We can see how they did serve the Lord in their capacity. Not only as a deacon, but also as a servant of God. No problem. There was a problem regarding food to eat. There was a council, and they were able to solve the problem. Why? Because they have one mind. Do you know why? Because they have Christ in them. And if you have Christ, then you will have the same mind. And you will have the same goal. And you will have the same disposition. But what is happening now? We are now infiltrated by a mixed multitude. We now have people in our pews that do not have Christ in them, that are not saved. I do not know, maybe there are one, two, three, or more that is sitting right here, right now, who is not saved. I do not know. There is always the possibility of self-deception. You might think or you might believe that you are saved, but if you are going to be honest with yourself and look back and analyze, examine yourself, you might even say that there was really no change. And if there was really no change, it means there was no salvation. Because the Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold. What do you mean by behold? See. Look. Something that is observable. Everything is new. So there should be a change in our lives if we are really saved. We do not believe in work salvation, because salvation is only by God's grace through faith. Without works, faith plus nothing. But if there is no fruit, then we need to question if there is really a root. If there is no good works, then let us ask ourselves if in the first place there was really faith. So that is why things evolve. Before, the congregation can make the decision. That's why most churches during the olden times are congregationalists. The church can make a decision. But then because of the unsaved people getting into the church, why? Because church became interested in numbers. They want to have more people in the church. They have to have more property, more beautiful buildings, more money, etc., etc. So they allow almost everybody who will profess faith even though there is no evidence. And then they will be sitting in the church and they will have a business meeting, church business meeting, and they could not agree. No decision is being reached. So the pastor or even the deacons became so discouraged and they said, let us do something. So it evolved into something else. Some churches now are deacon-led. The deacons will make the decision. And some churches now are just basically pastor-led. The pastor is the one who is making the decision for the church. And they call it theocracy. God's rule through one man. So the pastor now became the God inside the church. He cannot commit mistake because God is ruling through him. How can God make a mistake? How can the pastor be wrong if God is ruling through him? So now, the pastor will say, "That's not mine anointed, saith the Lord." So you cannot even question the pastor anymore. You cannot even challenge the pastor's teaching anymore, because the pastor is always right. They said, "We have a rule in this church. Number one, the pastor is always right. Number two, if the pastor is wrong, refer to rule number one." So there's nothing that you can do. And then they said that if God is the one who put the pastor in place, only God can remove the pastor. So he is beyond and above church discipline. Nobody can remove him, even though he will do things that are not according to the will of God. So what happened now? We are in this mess wherein we have deacon-led pastor churches, board-led churches, pastor-led churches, and the word of God is being set aside in favor of what these people believe and think will be working for the church. We are now worshiping the God of pragmatism. If it works, then that's okay. It doesn't matter if it is not in the word of God. That's why we are guarding against unregenerate church membership. Do you know why? Because it is impossible to disciple people who are not born again. Try to disciple a person who is not saved. You cannot do it. Why? They are dead in trespasses and sins. They could not understand the word of God. They may have worldly knowledge, but they do not know the Spirit of God. Look at Matthew 28:19-20. Look at the order of this. It is very clear from the word of God. "Go ye therefore and teach all nations," that is evangelism. After that, "baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost." So there must be salvation first, and then there will be baptism, obedience to the word of God. And then look at the order. Look, next verse, 20. "Teaching them to observe all things." Who? Those who were evangelized, those who were baptized, because they were saved. And because they are now saved, you can now disciple them. You can now teach them all things. Why? They have the Spirit of God. They can now understand the Word of God. I was in the Philippines when I witnessed to a lady. He's the accountant of a big university in Cabanatuan City. And then I witnessed to her together with my wife, Sister Maribel, and we presented the way of salvation. We presented repentance. And I did it several times. And then after that, I asked her if she understood that she's a sinner. She said yes. If she understood that because of her sin, she will die and she will go to hell. She said yes. And then that God loved her so much that God gave his only begotten son to die for her on the cross of Calvary. She said yes. And if you will repent of your sin and accept the Lord Jesus Christ, he promised that he will forgive you and he will give you eternal life. Do you believe that? She said yes. And then after that, she made a profession of faith. And then after that, I asked her, "So if you will die today, do you know where your soul will go?" She said, "I do not know." I said, "Have you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ?" He said, "Yes." "As what?" "As my Savior." "And he saved you from where?" "From the penalty of sin." "That's from hell, etc., etc." "So if you will die today, where will your soul go?" She said, "I do not know where." And we did that, I think, 5 times. And I was tempted to believe in predestination. Because no matter what I do, she could not understand. Of course, number one, I should realize that it is not I who will save her. My only job is to present the gospel and let the Holy Spirit do the saving. But you know, during that time, I was into easy believism, and I think that I can manipulate people into salvation. But then again, one thing that you need to understand is that A natural man cannot understand the word of God. And if you will put the natural man inside the church, and you try to disciple the natural man, he or she will not be able to understand the word of God, and there is going to be a problem inside the church. There must be first reconciliation with God before any discipleship. Look at Colossians 1, 21 to 22. Colossians 1, 21 to 22. The Bible says, "And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight." So you see, it is impossible to present men perfect in Christ Jesus unless they are in Christ. That is why the evidence of salvation, listen, is not only a changed life, but it is to continue in the faith, grounded and settled in the word of God. I do not know. You may judge me. You may say that, "I think, Pastor, you're wrong. And if you can prove it, then I will accept it." But if you have no interest whatsoever in continuing in the word of the Lord, in continuing in worshiping God, in continuing in attending the church, I don't believe. I'm sorry. I don't believe that you are really saved. Because a saved person will have a natural love for the Lord and for his word. Amen? And for the brethren. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ is very clear. If you are saved, if you are his disciple indeed, then you must have love for the brethren. And if there is no love, how can you even say that God is living in you? That is the reason why this is very important, because there is always, as I'm always telling you, the possibility of self-deception, believing that you are saved because somebody told you before that when you pray the prayer, then God saved you. And God already closed the door of hell for you. And that no matter what happens, you will go to heaven. And that is something that is very dangerous. So we can see the church is a body of people who have Christ in you. The church also is for the preparation of God's people. Look at verse number 28. "Whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus." Okay, contrary to popular belief, the goal of every church is not to build the kingdom of God. I do not know if you agree with this. Contrary to popular belief, the goal of the church is not to save the world. That is not the goal of the church. That is the work of the Holy Spirit. That is what is given to the church. That is a part of our ministry. But the goal of the church is to perfect the saint, to prepare them so that they can be presented spotless in the sight of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are not here to entertain. We are not here as a social club. We are not here as a sports venue. We are here in order to prepare the saints for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because like the servant who went there and find the wife for Isaac, we are here asked by God to go into all the world, preach the gospel, finding the wife, so that the wife will be presented perfect in her glory at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the job. That is the goal of the church. And in order for us to do that, we evangelize, we baptize, we teach, so that we can perform the duty that God has given us. How are we going to do this? Let us note, number one, we are to preach Christ. The Bible says, "Whom we preach." In our churches, we need to preach the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? We're not here to preach about politics. We're not here to preach about sports. We're not here to preach about the weather. The church is established by the Lord Jesus Christ so that we can preach on nothing but the Lord Jesus Christ and Him who was crucified and everything that has something to do with the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We are not here to preach about the preacher. We are not here to preach about the deacons. We are not here to preach about you. We are here to preach Jesus, because when the people approached Philip and Andrew, they said, "Sirs, we would need to see Jesus." It's about Jesus. It's not about me. It's not about you. But what's happening in our pulpit today, it's about the pastor. You see, my friend said that, he said, "Friend, since you became a missionary, you became anti-pastor." I said, "Why?" "Because why can you preach those kind of messages?" I said, "Because those messages are in the Bible. And I am just putting things in the proper perspective, because in the church, it is about Christ. It is not about us." Amen. Who told you that IBCSL is about Pastor Joel Madlang-awa? The Lord can remove me even now. And He can use somebody else. Why? Because this is His church. He saved this church. It belongs to Him. Amen. That's why nobody here can say that, "If not for me, my." Who do you think you are? It is only by the grace of God. It is a privilege that we can even serve God. We need to put that in our mind, that we will understand that everything is just a privilege given to us by the grace of God. In this church, the Lord Jesus Christ is preeminent in all things. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is the only mediator between God and man. He is the high priest, the chief shepherd. He is the head of the church. Christ is everything in this church. To Him be glory in the church. That's why there is no reason for us to take the limelight. You know, my friends ask me, "Can you preach at my church and preach about Pastor Sunday?" I said, "I cannot do it. Because Sunday belongs to the Lord. It is the Lord's day. Why will I preach about the pastor on a given Sunday? Because it is your birthday." You see, during Pastor Sunday, all the testimonies about the pastor. All the program is about the pastor. There is even a big picture showing the full life size of the pastor. And they have to give gifts for the pastor. Everything is about the pastor. Ladies and gentlemen, Sunday is the Lord's day. It is about the Lord Jesus Christ. It is for the Lord Jesus Christ. If it happens to be my birthday, I will do the same thing. I will glorify God. And when everything is over, we can eat. And you can sing happy birthday, that's it. But I do not have to take Sunday to be the pastor Sunday. Why will I do that? You see, we develop so many things today. We have October, the whole month of October, as the pastor's appreciation month. They ask me, "Pastor, is it wrong to appreciate the pastor?" It is not wrong. It is never wrong. But for the pastor to have the preeminence, it is always wrong. Because everything is about the Lord Jesus Christ. What happened when they started that Pastor Sunday, especially in the Philippines? You must give a gift to the pastor. One member from the church where I came from even have the audacity to post, "You do not love your pastor because you did not give him gifts during his birthday." We were judged. Actually, you were judged that you do not love me. And the reason is because you did not give me gift or gifts on my birthday. I told them, the members loved me and I love the members because we pray for each other. And there is no greater gift that you can give to your pastor than to pray for him, to lift him up in the Lord, and to always be in prayer for him. That is the best thing. And that is what I always ask from you. I do not need anything because the Lord will provide. If the Lord will provide through you, praise God. But what I need is your prayer because I am in a daily battle. And that is something that is very heavy and very hard. That we are going to, you know, be diverted and be sidetracked into these petty material things as a sign of love. Oh, we love our pastor. We gave him Toyota Fortuner. Well, thank God. But don't tell me that because you gave something to somebody, it means that you love him. Listen, you can give without loving. But you cannot love without giving, especially prayers for him, for the Lord. Amen? So that is something that is that we need to understand, that this is about the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why when we preach here, we are careful to lift only the Lord Jesus Christ, not other men. We're not going to say that, oh, Brother Mon is a better preacher than he. It doesn't matter. What's important is that we preach about the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? You see, I have this illustration whenever I preach about preaching the Lord Jesus Christ, that there was this man who is a Christian but who went to another place, a town, for a business. And he's traveling, and it so happens that it was Sunday that he was not in his home church. So the first thing that he did, as every Christian should do, is to find a church so that he can worship God. And then he went into a church and then entered the church, and he saw that the pastor is presentable, the pastor is a great preacher, the pastor is really a great orator, everything is homiletical, everything is in order. And after the preaching, he went out and he said, oh my, what a preacher. What a preacher. And he was blessed because of the goodness of the preacher, how good the preacher was. And then he traveled back to his place, but it was again time for a service. And he's not yet in his place, so he found again a church, and he entered into the church. And when he entered the church, the pastor is preaching about the Lord Jesus Christ. He's preaching about his sufferings. He's preaching about the agonizing death of the Lord Jesus Christ. He preached about everything about Jesus. And then after the preaching, he went out, and there were tears falling from his eyes, and he said, oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ will impact us more than what everybody or anybody can say about other things or somebody else. It is about the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? We are to aim to present every man. Let's go back to the verse, please. Whom we preach. Warning every man. You see, God doesn't save groups. He saves individuals. And he has an eternal plan for each of his redeemed saints. If you are saved today, listen to me. God has a plan for your life. But the next question is this. Do you know that plan? If you do not know, what are you doing? Try to find that plan from the Word of God, asking God to give you wisdom and to reveal to you his plan, because God will not hand that plan to you in a silver platter, that you're not doing anything, not exerting any effort, and he will just tell you, this is my plan for your life. We have the responsibility to find it and to obey it by the will of God. No one is to be neglected or left behind. That is why we are very particular. If one is absent, I think about that person. Why was he or she not here? What's happening? Why? Because everything that we study, everything that we preach, everything that we sing about in this church is very important. And it can help us grow in the Lord. You see, I know that we do not have the same level of growth. But what's important is that everybody should be growing by the grace of God. Amen? Why? Because every man is a member of the body. And if you're a member of a body, you have a spiritual gift, something that you can use in order to serve God and to glorify God. Everybody is an ambassador. So we represent the Lord Jesus Christ here on earth. everybody is a member of the priesthood. We can offer spiritual sacrifices directly to God. Everybody is part of a peculiar people, that we should be different from the world. Yes, we're in this world, but we should live differently by the grace of God. Why? Because we are sanctified for Him alone. The people are the Lord's, and each will give account of himself to Christ. That is why we have to be ready. But how? By learning and by serving the Lord. Listen, if you do not have any ministry in the church, repent and do something for the Lord. Why? Time will come that the Lord Jesus Christ will come, or we will die, and we will face Jesus at the judgment seat, and we will give an account for everything that we have done. What have you done? Are you going to sing that song, "Will I Wish I Had Given Him All"? Because you see, most of the time we only think about the things here on earth. We do not view things in the light of eternity. But that is how we should live. If you are risen with Christ, set your affection on things above, not on the things on this earth. Why? Because the things that are seen are temporal, but the things that are not seen are eternal. And only those with eternal value will linger all throughout eternity. And sad to say, most of us are not really that much interested in the things with eternal value. You see, the church job is to prepare each member to hear, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." That is what we are shooting for. That's why it says here, warning every man. Listen, if you will look at the order again, God is a God of order, amen? At the order again, warning is mentioned first, then teaching in the church. Why? Because it is emphasizing the importance of being warned. Why? Because as a church, we are in a spiritual battle. When the Apostle Paul is about to leave, he gathered the elders at Ephesus and he gave them warning. He said that for the span of 3 years, I have not ceased to warn you day and night with tears. Why? Because he says, I knew that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you. He emphasizes the spiritual battle that we are in. That is why he said, warning every man. That's why you might say that, Pastor, why is it that many of our preaching is about warning? Well, because that is what the Bible is telling us. We need to preach the whole counsel of God, but in the whole counsel of God, there is much about warning people regarding this danger of spiritual battle that we are in. You see, in the epistle of the Apostle Paul, there are three epistles, actually, in general two, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and Titus. And this epistle are what we know as pastoral epistle. And if you're going to read this epistle, you will see that most of those that are written in these epistles is about warning them about false teachers and wrong doctrines. Because that is the only, those are the only things, listen to me, that can defeat the church. You see, we have a lot of enemies outside of the church. That's okay. We know that they are our enemies. But it is very hard if the enemies are inside the church. That's why we're warned. That's why he said, warning every man. That we need to be careful in teaching every people to understand that there is a spiritual battle, and that we need to be exhorted to be sober and vigilant regarding these things. Listen, the ministry of warning is very hard. You see, when we embark in this particular endeavor, when we expose wrong teaching, when we expose wrong doctrines, you saw what happened? We lose so many friends. More than half of my friends proclaim that they are no longer my friends because of exposing these wrong doctrines, especially that what is happening in the Philippines. But how can you stay or keep quiet when you know that these people are teaching things that are depriving the people of God of their rights, spiritual rights? You see, there is a pastor who preaches that if you are a member of a particular church, you will remain a member of the church until you die. Even if you go to other places, you cannot transfer your membership, but you keep on sending your tithes to that church. What kind of doctrine is that? That is a doctrine filled with greed regarding money. We have two Filipinas who attended the church. You remember them? They already decided to join the church because they will be staying here for a long time. I think they've been here for 6 or 7 years now. But the pastor said, no, you cannot transfer your membership. You only attend there, but you send your tithes back home. Where are they now? They're attending another church and they are living like worldly people. They are even now unequally yoked with unbelievers. Why? Because they are not being taught. For what reason? So that they can send their tithes back home. We made all the adjustments, ladies and gentlemen. We only want to glorify God. We talked to them. And what did we say? Okay, you transfer your membership because that is God's will. And then once you give your offering, the amount of your offering we will send to your former church as a love gift of our church. So that money will not come in between you obeying God. Still, the answer of the pastor is no. You just turn on your Skype or whatever it is and watch our live stream every Sunday, no matter how spiritual you are. If you neglect the assembling of the saints, then you are a very easy prey for the devil. And their lives are now being destroyed. Why? Because of money. And we warn them. We expose it. Why? Because it is a ministry given to us by the Lord. Look at this, Acts 20, 31. We'll just read several verses and we will move on and finish this. Anyway, if we may take a little bit longer, it's because the food is already there. That's the good thing about it. It is always good to eat when you're very hungry. The food will taste delicious. Have you noticed that? When you're very hungry, all kinds of food is delicious. But if not, you're going to be picky. Okay, therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years, I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. Just imagine that. 3 years, he says, I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. Just imagine the ministry of the Apostle Paul there at Ephesus. Look at the Ephesians chapter 5, verse 11. And have no fellowship with unfruitful work of darkness, but rather reprove them. You see? They said, no, you just have to be quiet. Do not say anything against them. That is hate speech. That is not politically correct. No, what the Bible says is correct, and the Bible is our final authority. He said, have no fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Amen. Tell them that they are wrong, according to the authority of the word of God. 1 Thessalonians 5:14. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient toward all men. That's why, listen, if you are unruly, you will be warned. They will say, umayos ka. You live a life that is according to God's will. Why? We are commanded to warn the unruly. Look at 1 Timothy 5:20. Despise not prophesying to little mo them that sin, rebuke before all that others also may fear. Look how hard this ministry is. You try to do this ministry and see what people will say against you. Them that sin rebuke before all. This is talking about public sin. Sin that is known. That others also may fear. You try to do this and they will say, you are not a tender, loving person. You are just mean. Pure mean. But ladies and gentlemen, there is a time for everything. If they do not want to change, if they do not want to follow the word of God, then one of our ministers is to rebuke. 2 Timothy 4:2. This is given to Timothy, a leader. Preach the word, being sent in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. Very clear, reproving and rebuking is a ministry of the people of God, especially the pastors or the leaders of the church. Titus chapter 1 verse 13. This witness is true. Wherefore, rebuke them sharply. Kuha ka muna ng panghasa. Make it sharper. Rebuke them sharply that they may be sound in the faith. You're not doing this for the sheer joy of rebuking people or showing that you're in authority. You are doing this because of love. You do not want them to live in a life that is not according to the will of God. Much like disciplining our children, it is not enjoyable to spank your children, but it is necessary so that they will learn to live according to the word of God. And one more verse, chapter 2, verse number 15. This thing speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. You see, even though Timothy and Titus were young, but they said, there is an authority given to you. Use it in order to help people that God may be glorified. And then Revelation 3:19. This is from the Lord. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. Amen. Listen to me, Christian, look at me. When you are being rebuked, it's not because we hate you. You are being rebuked because we love you. And we are not going to do it in order to put you to shame. It is being done so that you will be presented without blame before God. That is the purpose. It is love. The Bible says, open rebuke is better than secret love. Why is this ministry necessary? Because we are still in the flesh. And the flesh is always contrary to the spirit. And then next, every man is to be taught, teaching every man. So this refers to teaching the whole counsel of God. That's why in our church, we endeavor to teach everything by the grace of God. Like for example, on Tuesday, preachers, listen to me. We are going to discuss about marriage, divorce, and remarriage. I already gave you the assignment so that you can dig deeper into the Word of God, because it is very relevant now in the Philippines, because one of the so-called pastor politician that is representing us is in favor of divorce. And we need to see if he is right or wrong by using the word of God. We do not want to be unfair with anybody. We will study the word of God, we will look at this stand, and we will make a church stand regarding marriage, divorce, and remarriage, because we want to do everything according to God's word. Who knows? One day it may happen to a member of us. So when that thing happens, we will know what to do. So that is what we're going to do. So Tuesday, preachers, please be prepared for a discussion regarding marriage, divorce, and remarriage. Because I think Brother Paspi is considering to, not for a divorce, to tighten and enrich his love towards rejoice. Amen? That is the consideration of Brother Paspi. And then not only that, this ministry is to be done with all wisdom. Because without wisdom, we might not know the difference between hurting people and helping people. And then this ministry is to aim for perfection. Not to be sinlessly perfect, but to be matured and to be truly furnished unto all good works. That is what we are shooting for. Let us not be content with a low level of spirituality. Let us keep on keeping on. We will stumble, we will fall. Yesterday, what did we study? How to help a fallen brother. Why do we need that kind of ministry? Because somebody will stumble, somebody will fall, and we cannot shoot our own wounded. We need to help them back to their feet so that all of us can go together, move forward, and glorify God in our lives. And this ministry requires much labor. Look at verse number 29. And we're almost done. Whereunto I also labor, striving according to this working, which worketh in me mightily. It means if ever we're going to be successful in this ministry, we need to be giving all, straining every nerve, every effort that we can in order to achieve this objective. That's why, ladies and gentlemen, listen to me. Before we end this thing, listen to me. That's why everybody should contribute for the achievement of this goal. You cannot just sit down there and do nothing. You cannot be an additional weight for the church. You should be a pillar that is carrying this church through the grace and the help of God. So do not just be a decoration or a nominal Christian. Do something. We must be a part of whatever we may accomplish in this church. This ministry requires God's working. But in doing so, we depend on the power of the Lord. And our end goal is to present every man. And that is to present every member of this church by the grace of God, perfect before God, matured, fully grown. By the grace of God. Why? Because this church is Christ's flock. And it is hard to imagine that after the Lord giving us so many years to be together, that we will stand in front of the Lord Jesus Christ and basically accomplish nothing. You see, the Lord has given us the Holy Spirit. The Lord has given us His Holy Word. The Lord has given us enough grace. Listen to me. Look at me. There is no reason why we will fail. We will only fail if we allow ourselves to get into the way. But if we will deny ourselves and just allow the Lord to live in us and through us, Galatians 2:20, then by the grace of God, we will be able to be a kind of church that is perfecting every member. Amen? Shall we stand up, please? Every head's bowed, please.